And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You are Alpha and Omega. We worship you alone. You are worthy to be praised.
Let's try that again with the one voice.
His name. Our call to worship is coming from Hebrews 4, verses 12 through 16, the New King James Version, and it reads, "For the word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and spirit and joints and marrow, and is discerning to the thought and intent of the heart. And there's no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to his eyes of him to whom we must give account. Seeing then that he have a great high priest who has passed through the heaven, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all point tempered as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need." Amen. Can you please share with us at this time and join me on page 566 in your hymnal as we sing our opening hymn, "Revive Us Again." We'll be singing all four verses together.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now from above. Hallelujah, thank you. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Verse 2. Praise thee, O God, for the Spirit of life, who on us thou say.
Let us pray. Oh, matchless and powerful Lord, we gather here this morning, Lord, hearts filled of gratitude and praise. We thank you for bringing us together as a community of believers, Lord, united in a purpose and with love. We invite your Holy Spirit into this place today, Lord, as you move around this room from heart to heart and breast to breast, filling this place and touching every heart present. Father, we ask for your guidance. We ask that you open our minds and our hearts to your word and help us to be teachable, humble, and available in all things. Grant us the humility to recognize our needs for growth and transformation, and make us available and willing instruments to your will. Let us worship, be pleasing to you, and may the message we receive today inspire us to live out our faith more deeply. But then, Father, we pray because we know that you're powerful enough to just say, come, and things will happen. So, Father, we ask for those that are affected by the storm, Helena. Father, we ask, Lord, that you move in their lives right now, Father, and allowing them to see you, allowing them to have calm and peace. Lord, please continue to inspire us to live out our faith more deeply. Help us to support one another in kindness, compassion, and understanding, just as you have shown us through the life of your Son, Jesus Christ. So as we continue to strive to be a community that reflects your love and grace, we come together in unity to pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And our prayer response is, He's sweet, I know. Together, Northside.
He's sweet. Strong winds
seated in the presence of the Lord. Good morning, Northside. I want to greet you all in the name that's above all names, and that's Jesus the Christ. I want to welcome those that's on Facebook Live and other online broadcasts that we have. I want to welcome most of all you all here in the sanctuary. You all recognize that on the fifth Sunday that we all dressed in the attire of the motherland, and you all looked really beautiful from up here. Just want to share that. I thank you all for your presence. I ask if any visitors are joining us today, or if any of you, the disciples of Northside, brought a visitor with you, I ask that you stand, introduce your visitor, and introduce them to your church family. Amen. 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 My brother here to the right. Good morning. Thank you. Thank you. We're thankful that you found it not robbery to come by and visit with us and join us in worship today. Amen. Northside, let us share with our visiting guests on Facebook Live and here in the sanctuary our vision together. Northside Baptist Church is intentional about making and growing disciples and empowering people to live changed lives. Amen. And our theme for this year is simply walking by faith, found in 2 Corinthians 5:7. Announcements. There will be a church business meeting immediately following service today. All Northside disciples should plan to attend. The Spirit Dance Ministry will rehearse on the following days this week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday at 7:45 p.m. and on Saturday at 1 p.m. If you're interested, please see us after church. Deacon Kamika Cheatham will be available to register those that are not registered to vote starting this Sunday. And I have to get an end date for us, but starting this Sunday following services. So this Sunday, the following Sunday, and well, first Sunday next week and the second, and then I'll give you more information on that later. Bible study will continue via Zoom on Wednesdays at 12 p.m. We are reading the Misreading Scripture with Western Eyes by E. Randolph Richards and Brandon J. O'Brien. The meeting ID is in your bulletin. Please join us on Mondays and Wednesdays at 6:45 p.m. as we pray for situations and things that may be going on, not only in our lives, but in the lives of others. I know I constantly talk about one relationship, but then also the chaos and stuff that's going on around us. I just ask that during that time, we pray for those things so that it can be peace surrounding each and every last one of us. The Hand in Hand Women's Ministry prayer call will continue on Saturdays at 10:15 a.m. The prayer dial-in number is in your bulletin and also the access code. Sunday School for Adults continue on Sunday mornings at 9:30 a.m. and Sunday School for Children and Youth will begin at 10 a.m. We are in person. Strive to Thrive in 2025 will be distributing workbooks for children and some adults. It started last month, but it'll continue this month on the third Sunday, so that we are aware. At this time, I'll hand this over to our marvelous pastor, Pastor Walter L. Parrish III, as he come up and give us further instructions. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Deacon Lewis. Good morning to each and every one of you. Grace and peace to you through Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. It is good to be with you. It is good to see you. For those of you who are joining us online, Thank you to our tech team who makes this possible every week. We do not take for granted what you do upstairs. Most of the time, it's hotter in the balcony than it is on the floor, and they manage to handle their business with the heat and with all the other challenges. God bless you. 37 days, y'all, till Election Day. 37 days, all right? Deacon Lewis announced Deacon Cheatham is going to be signing people up. Just in case you don't know who she is, Deacon Kamika Cheatham, would you please stand up so that if anybody by some strange chance does not know who you are, thank you. This is who you see. And if you know somebody who needs to get registered to vote, but they're not here today, bring them to church next Sunday. You can do two things. You can bring them to Jesus, and you can bring them so they can be ready to vote. Amen. So please, y'all, all jokes aside, and Northside is a polling place. I think many of us know that. That's right. We are always glad to welcome persons who will come and just sit in the building on Election Day. There's something about being able to be part of that process that for so many years was withheld from people who look like you and me. And they tried to make it difficult for us to vote with poll taxes and questions, and now we can just walk in and vote freely. And unfortunately, too many of us take it for granted. Well, there's an opportunity for you to just come and be present in the midst. You may or may not vote here. You don't have to vote here, but we invite you to just come and be with us. Many of us are aware that in this last week, Reverend Dr. Cecilia Bryant made her transition from labor to reward. When you are part of a family that is as well known as the Bryants are, people have a tendency to think that you don't need prayer. Far from that is the reality that because so much is frequently expected of families like that, they are even more worthy of our prayers in this season. So let us please continue to remember the Bryant family. Let me thank you, Northside, for the ways that you turned out on Friday and the ways that you have been supporting the family of Sister Alicia Greer. They were so moved, they gave me a note Friday, and I want to read it to you. It says, to the Northside Baptist Church, from the bottom of our hearts, we thank you so much for your help and support during this time. We knew that Mom and Granny would be so proud of how you came together for her. We appreciate you so much. Love always, Cicely, Kayla, and family. And so this belongs to you, and this will be posted on the bulletin board of our church. Thank you so much. Lastly, a bit of personal privilege. Please, Jonathan is not a social media person, but our eldest has his birthday today, and I know he's not the only one who celebrates a birthday today. So thank you for just thinking of him. And then one of the dangers of being the son of the minister of music is that there might be occasions when you get drafted or voluntold that you're going to step in. So Josiah, God bless you. We thank you for being available. God bless you. Those are the announcements we need to share. I need to say something, and then I'm going to say what I normally say. I want to thank those of you who have been consistent and faithful in giving throughout the year. Frequently, churches experience a dip in the summertime because we travel, we take on other commitments, and Northside has not been exempt from that this year. You will hear in the business meeting, we're going to be all right, but we can do better. We can always do better. When we think about how God has blessed us, the fact that we would figure out how to go away on money we would ordinarily have given to support the work of ministry, and then, okay, so we're going to make sure that we are clear about how we're going to recover from our summer slump, all right? Amen. It's time to worship God with the giving of God's tithes and our offerings. Thank you. The free market, thank you, is 2 weeks away. Saturday, October 12, we're going to have the free market. That announcement is in your bulletin. Also in your bulletin is the announcement about our fall festival. And Dr. Thomas, come on. So she's the only person who could do this. Come on.
No, I just wanted to reiterate that if you bring things for the free market, yes. You don't get taken,
yes.
You have to take them back.
Yes. We are. Yeah. Let me just, yes, thank you. The first church I served in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, the DeVoe Street Baptist Church, had suffered decline, and they resorted to thrift sales every quarter as a result of their decline in membership. The problem was, when the sale was over, there were still things left in the church. And when the Lord first called me to that church, one of the first things I could actually still smell then, I walked in that church and I smelled clothes. Y'all know that smell. That had been there for years on end. And one of the first things we did was we got rid of all of them and trusted God with the tithe instead of the thrift sale. Amen? Amen. So yes, we want you to come. If you've got things that you want to give away and you want to see somebody else have them, great, fabulous, wonderful, tremendous. But when it's over, we need you to take home what other people didn't take from you. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right. Now we're going to lift towards heaven. The method, the device by which we give, and I invite you to repeat after me the affirmation we make. Divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies this gift. It blesses the receiver and returns to the giver, blessed and multiplied. Amen. We give our tithe, we give the change for change, and if the Lord has moved you to give benevolence, we give that as well. Won't you stand, please, follow the direction of the finest ushers, N.T. Ware. Look at them. Look, even the ushers got, look, my goodness, they look so good. Amen. Come on, let's follow the leadership of our ushers and bring the tithe and the offering as unto the Lord. Amen.
Now, oh, oh, oh,
I believe,
I believe,
I believe,
oh, I believe,
I believe,
oh, I'll have my mansion now, oh, 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 I believe just what he said, oh, through Christ I'll do all things, oh, 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 I believe, oh, I believe, through Christ, oh, 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 I believe just what he said. Oh, he shall supply my needs, oh, 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 I believe, oh, I believe. Oh, he shall supply my needs, oh, 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 I believe just what he said.
Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for the opportunity to bring tithes into your storehouse,
yeah,
God.
Yeah.
May it be used for the preaching of the gospel, for the feeding of the hungry, for the clothing of the naked,
yes,
and for the changing of lives.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God, for whom all blessings flow.
Praise God. Yeah.
Come on, Northside, let's put those hands together for the Lord. Let's put those hands together. Sinking in the sea of sin and shame, but Jesus found me and he changed my name. He could have let
me drown.
He could have
let me drown.
He could have
let me drown.
But instead he took me in. I was sinking in the sea of sin and shame, but Jesus found me and he changed my name. He could have
let me drown.
He could have
let me drown.
He could have
let me drown.
But instead he took me in. God's love lifted me. God's love lifted me. When nothing else would help, love lifted me. I tell you that love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Y'all know what? Y'all know what? He could have
let me cry.
He could have let me drown. He could have let me drown. He could have let me drown. He could have let me drown.
Let me drown.
But instead, he took me in. God's love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. I tell you that
love lifted me.
I tell you, love lifted me. When nothing else could help. He could have let me drown. He could have
let me drown.
He could have let me drown. He could have let me drown.
Let me drown.
But instead he took me in. He could have
let me drown.
He could have let me drown. He could have let me drown.
He could have let me drown.
He could have
let me drown,
but instead he took me in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Somebody knows that it was only because he did not let us down. We tried to sink all by ourselves, didn't we? Some of us fought the Lord when the Lord first tried to save us, but thank God that God didn't give up on us. Hallelujah. If you are able, I invite you to stand, please, as we read our scripture lesson.
It comes to us today from the fifth book in the New Testament, the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4. We'll be reading verses 13 through 22. Acts chapter 4. Reading verses 13 through 22. Choir worked up a sweat, y'all. They back here. And we are better for it. We are better because of it. Amen. Reading in the New Revised Standard Version, here's what you will find. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and realized that they were uneducated and ordinary men, they were amazed and recognized them as companions of Jesus. When they saw the man who had been cured standing beside them, they had nothing to say in opposition. So they ordered them to leave the council while they discussed the matter with one another. They said, "What will we do with them? For it is obvious to all who live in Jerusalem that a notable sign has been done through them. We cannot deny it. But to keep it from spreading further among the people, let us warn them to speak no more to anyone in this name." So they called them and ordered them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John answered them, "Whether it is right in God's sight to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge, for we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and heard." After threatening them again, they let them go, finding no way to punish them because of the people, for all of them praised God for what had happened. For the man on whom this sign of healing had been performed was more than 40 years old. Read in your hearing, Acts chapter 4, verses 13 through 22. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Please join me in a word of prayer. Use me now, Lord, I pray, so that someone this day will know that you are all we need. Take these words, use them, change them. But God, have your way in this moment. Somebody needs to know that you still care. Somebody needs to know that you're still able. Somebody needs to know that you're still listening to the prayers we pray. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. For we cannot keep from speaking about what we have seen and heard. As the Lord allows today, I want to talk about no stopping. No stopping. The fifth book of our New Testament, the Acts of the Apostles, as those of us who've had a chance to go to Sunday school or come to Bible study, we'll remember that this book is in many ways a history text. It chronicles, it reports, it records, and it captures a testimony to the amazing, upsetting, and wondrous works done by the apostles shortly after Jesus died. Jesus has died, has been resurrected, and has returned to heaven as Scripture had both promised and predicted. There he has returned to his rightful place, where he is, as Hebrews chapter 12 tells us, seated at the right hand of God Almighty. The earthly work is now entrusted to this recently inducted and still wet behind the ears group of people known as disciples, who are to continue the work Jesus started on earth. Unfortunately, they have not been left with a manual. They don't have guidelines, parameters. They don't have instructions or steps. There is no 800 number to call. There is no help desk that's staffed from 9 a.m. until 6 p.m. There are no apps that they can pull up on their phone when they have questions. There are no group chats, men of valor, for them to post questions on. Messenger is not available. DMs are not available. Other aids have not been created, and certainly AI is not even thought about. However, for all that they don't have, they are not without help. They have help. They have a presence. Jesus has promised them that he would not leave them comfortless. And you know, if there's one person whose promises we can trust, Jesus is at the top of that list. He had promised them that they would be able to tread on snakes and not be harmed. Having seen Jesus heal the sick, restore the lost, and raise the dead, they remembered that he had promised them that having seen all of that, greater things than those would they do. He made them a promise to send them a comforter who would, as John chapter 14 tells us, be an advocate, a supporter, a backer, an activist, who would be with them, newsflash, and us forever. This advocate's job description would be accompanied by the performance of signs and wonders as evidence that what Jesus said was both trusted and true. The only problem was Jesus has returned to heaven. Jesus is not there to walk with them day in and day out. In some ways, they're like us. They were left with the promises, but they didn't really know what to do with them. They were left with the assurances, but they had to figure out how to activate them. It's kind of like the last time my family gave me a new cell phone. I had not asked for it, because I knew how the old one worked. I started trying to read the manual. I think they print those things in 0.6 font. And finally, I had to give it to one of Dr. Thomas's very smart sons and say, would you please make this thing work? That's us. We've got access to it. We're holding it. We can pull the paper off of it. We can release it from the tape. We know how to turn it on and off. We know how to plug it in and charge it, but we don't really know how to use it. They did have a couple of clues. They said, well, maybe if we just do things in Jesus' name, things will happen. And these ordinary folk, these people who dropped their nets when they heard his voice, these people who trusted him when he said, if you follow me, I will make you fishers of men and women. They were like us in many ways, not just not knowing how to operate what they had been given, but they had families. They had loved ones that they left behind. And when they were told,
What you are about to do is of such great impact in the world that if you don't do it, woe be unto you. And if you read the book of Acts, they did their best to follow his instructions. Because that's what the book of Acts is. It is a recording of the acts done by the Holy Spirit, whose presence Jesus had promised through the Holy Spirit. And for as much as we have widely become a world where the gospel is preached freely, the days in which these disciples lived were dangerous days to heal the sick, raise the dead, and preach the resurrection of those who believed in Jesus. But they did it anyway. There's this way in which every time these disciples spoke, they grew stronger and more confident each time. Remember that very first Bible verse you memorized? Jesus wept. Come on, really. Come on, let's just do a survey. First Bible verse you memorized, Jesus wept. Let me see your hands. Okay, I knew I was going to be in good company. But as we have grown and lived and grown, we found that the Word of God is so much richer than those two words. And that its promises to change people's lives have mandated that we learn more about Jesus. More about Jesus would I know. More of his love to others show. More of his saving fullness see. More of his love who died for me. More about Jesus. Every time they spoke, they grew stronger and more confident. Just listen to how they answer the questions about the man, the crippled man who they saw on their way in to pray. Listen to what Peter says to the folk who are trying to throw him out of church. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are questioned today because of a good deed done to someone who was sick and are asked how this man was healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that this man is standing before you in good health by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified." Peter doubles down. I'm sorry, that's a Peter ups the ante. He says, "Listen, the only reason we're in this place is because y'all killed Jesus. If y'all had let Jesus do what he was supposed to do, we wouldn't be having this conversation right now." How many times I've wanted to say that to folk? If you would just let Jesus do what Jesus is trying to do, you will sleep better at night. You would just let Jesus do what he's trying to do in your life. You would have peace in your home. If you would just let Jesus do what Jesus is trying to do, you would be a lot happier and content. But they make a bad situation worse. They go on, verse 11, earlier in that chapter, they say, "This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you," part two, "and now it has become the cornerstone. It's the one, Jesus is the name on which everything else is built." Clearly, Peter was not trying to win a popularity contest. Peter was not looking for nominations to win Mr. Congeniality for that year. He was on it. He was in it. And Peter would not let this thing go. And with good reason. God had moved in people's lives. God had freed people through the work of the Holy Spirit from bodily illness and
physical limitations. God had freed people from spiritual bondage, and through Jesus, God had made it possible for you and me to walk with certainty in the knowledge that we are no longer bound by sin, we are not prisoners of our past, and that in Jesus we have new, rich, vibrant, and eternal life. Peter said, no, we're not stopping now. Some may not like it, but this is their problem, not ours. We are on assignment. We are under orders. We have a plan. We have a purpose. We have a savior, Charles Wesley. Some of you know that name. 18th century pastor and leader of the Methodist movement penned these words that if you've ever been in the South, you've heard deacons line this song. A charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save, and fit it for the sky, to serve the present age, my calling to fulfill. Oh, may it all my powers engage to do my master's will. That's you and me. We have this charge and we can't stop now. Hall Johnson, let me bring it a little bit closer to our own moment. Hall Johnson, born March 12, 1888 in Athens, Georgia, educated as a black man at the Juilliard School, among others, had his own way of expressing it. He says, Lord, I keep so busy praising my Jesus. Keep so busy praising my Lord that I ain't got time to die. Because it takes all of my time to praise my Jesus, all of my time to praise my Lord. If I don't praise him, if you don't praise him, if we don't praise him, the rocks will cry out. I'm not trying to have any mountain of rocks take my place, because God's been too good. Glory and honor, glory and honor. They say there can be no stopping. Acts 4:18 reports that the council, though, had decided that enough was enough. The council that did not have the power or the desire to do what was being done through the apostles, this group was who they described as, and some of y'all heard it earlier, uneducated and ordinary folk. So they called them and said to them, y'all better stop. All this Jesus talk, all of this changing people's lives, empowering people to live, change lives, y'all better stop. Yeah. Yeah. You know, friends, every time I get disencouraged, as my friend Jonathan Staples would say, I remember this. And I offer it to you today because there will be days when the crown council will convene on your life. There will be days when family will tell you it doesn't take all of that. Friends will tell you, come on and just hang out with us. Folk you knew in your past job and past life will say, come on, let's do it the old way. And you're going to have to be the one to say, no, I'm not stopping. I'm not going back, because I know how far the Lord has brought me, and I know how good God has been to me. I know what things God has kept me from, and I know what things God has kept from me. Not stopping. Whether it's right in God's sight for us to listen to you or not, I don't know. But here's what I do know. I'm not stopping. There's just something, you know. I love watching y'all. I've had a chance to watch y'all several times this weekend. I love watching y'all. When Jesus has made a difference in your life, you can't hide it. You can try to put a cover over it, but it doesn't work.
The Jesus in me sees the Jesus in you. When I see you glad to help, sir, when I see you ready and willing and able to do what nobody else will do, it's a clear sign that the Lord has stopped in your life and the Lord has stayed long enough to say unto you, thou art my beloved. And just like the apostles who lived then said no stopping, what we must do is make sure we tell everybody we can that we know somebody who can turn every upside down situation right side up. No stopping. As we tell others that he is not only to help, he's not only willing to help, but he also knows how to heal. No stopping. No stopping as we tell others that he's a friend that will never leave you. No stopping. No stopping as we tell others that Jesus will walk right beside you. No stopping. No stopping as we declare the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. No stopping. No stopping as we reach the masses, folk of every birth. For an answer, Jesus gave the key. And if I be lifted up, I'll draw all souls unto me. No stopping. In season, no stopping. Out of season, no stopping. When things are good, no stopping. When things are falling apart, no stopping. When the devil behaves, no stopping. When the devil acts crazy, no stopping. We can't stop. God has brought us too far. God's been too good to us. We've seen too much. We've heard too much. I talked about Charles Wesley. I talked about Hall Johnson. But let me just bring somebody's name up who those of us who are in this room might know. Keith Pringle. Keith Pringle says it this way. If we confess the Lord, call him up. If you confess the Lord, call him up. If you confess the Lord, call him up and do what? Tell him what you want. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Even though sometimes you stumble, yes. Even though sometimes you fall, call him up and tell him what you want. But wait, that's not the best part. The best part is when you called him and he's answered, when he showed up in your midnight hours, then you can say what Brother Pringle says, can't stop praising my Jesus. Can't stop praising my Lord. I just can't stop praising his name. Saints, we cannot stop. There is no stopping because of what God has done, what God is doing. And through you, what God wants to do. We're going to sing that song as our hymn of invitation. Because there's somebody who is in this room joining us on the broadcast who needs to testify that you're not going to stop. That when you confess the Lord, you're going to call him up and you're going to tell him what you want. The door of the church is open. The invitation to discipleship is extended. God wants to use you to make a difference in somebody else's life. We invite you. The door of the church is open. Call him.
Call him up.
If you confess the Lord.
If you confess the Lord.
Call him up.
Call him up.
We invite you. Is there one?
If you confess the Lord.
Won't you come?
Call him up.
Call him up.
If you believe,
and the Holy Ghost,
invite you.
Come on, let's have some worship. Let's have some worship. Come on, go ahead.
If you confess the Lord,
call him, call him.
Call him up.
If you confess the Lord,
if you confess the Lord, call him up.
Ah, yeah, sound like some folk know him.
If you confess the Lord, call him up.
Call him, call him, call him.
If you confess the Lord,
call him up. If you believe on the Father,
if you believe on the Father,
as the Son,
and the Holy Ghost,
call him up,
call him up.
And tell him,
and tell him what you want.
Come on, we came to worship.
Bless his name, bless his name, bless his name. The angel told Mary, nothing shall be impossible. All we've got to do is believe it. Walk in it. Live like it. Because our God is able. That's why we need worship before we talk business. Because if we claim God in this room, then when we go down the hall, we're going to watch God in the next room. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Let me ask that we would take 10 minutes from the time the benediction is given. I will not go to the door. We will get ourselves ready, move chairs. All of those of you who are with us today who are disciples of Northside, we look forward to you being present. Will give me a chance to greet our visitors one more time, those who are not yet part of this fellowship. God bless you, Northside, and God bless those of you who are joining us online. You make every day better because you are willing to follow God. Amen? Let us stand and receive our benediction, and then we'll get ready to go forward. God, we thank you for showing up today and for standing in with us when we don't know what to do or how to do it. So now, God, we pray that you will continue to keep your hand on each of us. Those who will be leaving now, grant traveling mercies. Those who will be leaving in a little while, guide them safely over the highways and the byways. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you henceforth and even forevermore. That all of God's people sing together. God bless you.
Your soul's not.